Okay, so let me start my talk with a disclaimer. I'm a theoretical physicist, and there will be one formula in my presentation. More specifically, I work in the field of fundamental physics, and the ambitious goal of fundamental physics is to address some profound questions, like, what is the universe made of? What are the fundamental forces of nature? And what is the nature of space-time and matter? There are also several questions that we cannot address, even though they are very interesting, and most of these questions start with why. Now, I want to zoom in on the first of these questions, what is the universe made of? So, if I would have given this talk more than a century ago, I probably would have answered, well, the universe is made of atoms. At that time, atoms were considered to be the fundamental building blocks of matter, of everything in this room, it was atoms. But now we know that atoms are not fundamental, they consist of electrons, neutrons, protons, and the protons themselves are not fundamental neither, they consist of quarks. So now we have a somewhat simpler picture than the full periodic table of chemical elements. We have this small kind of periodic table of elementary particles, and these particles and all their interactions describe everything that is going on in this room, for instance. However, when you try to apply this to the universe as a whole, you find something very embarrassing. Namely, all the particles that we know, together with all the forces that we know, they make up less than 5% of the energy content of the universe. So in other words, there's more than 95% of the universe that we don't understand with our current understanding of elementary particle physics. And about one quarter of the universe consists of so-called dark matter, and almost three quarters of dark energy. So how do we know this, and what is dark matter? Well, let me try to address this with a historic precedent, namely the discovery of Neptune. So in 1821, Alexis Bouvard published tables that he calculated of the orbit of Uranus. And interestingly, the observations of the trajectory of Uranus deviated from this table. So there was a gravitational anomaly, and the observations did not coincide with these theoretical predictions. And to bridge this gap between theoretical prediction and experimental observation, there were two different logical possibilities available. Either you predict something like dark matter, you predict some invisible planet located close to Uranus that distorts its trajectory so that it coincides with the observed one, or you change the theory. You declare Newton's theory to be not quite valid, but you have to modify it. And in 1845, these two gentlemen, especially Urban Le Verrier, predicted a new planet, so they used this dark matter paradigm and calculated its position. And amazingly, a year later, this planet was found, and it was called Neptune. So the discovery of Neptune was the first success of the dark matter concept. Of course, after its discovery, it was no longer dark. Okay. Interestingly, there's another story that is very related, but it has completely the opposite ending. So in the same century, it was also discovered that Mercury has some problem with its trajectory. So the calculated tables of the trajectory of Mercury did not coincide with the observed ones. So that was another instance of a gravitational anomaly. And again, the same kind of two different logical possibilities existed. Either you predict some form of dark matter, for instance, a new planet, or you change the theory of gravity. And the same person who theoretically predicted Neptune also predicted another planet, namely Vulcan. So Urban Le Verrier predicts a new planet and calculates its position in 1859. And interestingly, this planet was discovered in 1860, so 1 year later. This planet is called Vulcan, and it's supposed to orbit the Sun in an orbit that is closer to the Sun than Mercury, so it would have been a planet closer than Mercury. However, this observation was never confirmed by anyone else, and now we know that Vulcan does not exist. The story has a different ending, but this issue was not resolved until Albert Einstein came along in 1915, constructed general relativity, and this new theory of gravity then fully explains the trajectory of Mercury. So the non-discovery of Vulcan was the first failure of the dark matter concept. Now, in astrophysics today, we have a couple of gravitational anomalies. So again, discrepancies between theory and observation. And I'm going to show you the most prominent example. These are the so-called galactic rotation curves. So what you see in this curve here is the velocity of the stars in the galaxy around the center of the galaxy, plotted as a function of the radial distance from the center. And if you take general relativity and calculate this velocity profile, you get this dashed curve here. So this is the theoretical prediction. However, when you actually observe the galaxies, what you find is this solid line here. So this is the observation. So at large distances, we have a gravitational anomaly, we have a discrepancy between theory and observation. There's also, at the smaller scale, a gravitational anomaly, the Pioneer anomaly. Pioneer spacecraft were sent out in the 70s and 80s to explore our solar system. And since then, we have been monitoring the trajectory of these spacecrafts very precisely, so we can very accurately determine the trajectory. And from this, we can deduce that there's an anomalous acceleration towards the sun. So that's another instance of a gravitational anomaly. The trajectory that we observe does not quite coincide with the trajectory that we calculate. So the key question seems to be, are we in a Vulcan or in a Neptune scenario? Now, most scientists, including myself, consider the Vulcan scenario to be unlikely and the Neptune scenario to be likely. So it really seems that there is some sort of dark matter in our universe, but the problem is that it has not been detected yet directly, and there are many different acronyms and candidates for dark matter. Perhaps one of them will be discovered at the LHC at CERN in the next decade. But right now, we don't have a good clue what dark matter is. And we shouldn't forget that the main success of the Neptune story was not just that Neptune was predicted theoretically, but also that it was observed. So at the moment, we're just in the stage where dark matter is predicted, but not yet observed. And due to this, some people have quasi-religious feelings about these issues, whether Vulcan or Neptune scenario is true. So the question is, how can we make progress? Well, the most straightforward strategy would be to show that either Vulcan or Neptune scenario is correct. But unfortunately, both strategies are currently out of reach. So how can we make progress on the theory side? Well, my strategy was to actually remain agnostic about this issue and to rephrase the question, even though this sounds a bit like cheating. So the question that I want to address is, what is the most general theory of gravity that is possible at large distances? So the input was to make the model as simple as possible, because otherwise I can't do anything. And one of the simplifying assumptions was to impose spherical symmetry. So if you look around yourself, then this room doesn't look spherically symmetric at all. But if you move a couple of thousand kilometers upwards, then the Earth starts to look more and more like a perfect round sphere. So at large distances, gravity behaves as if it was spherically symmetric. And the same applies to the sun, to stars, and to many galaxies. I had to use another assumption, the absence of certain pathologies at large distances. This is also known as cosmic censorship conjecture. It basically states that gravity should not become arbitrarily large in the universe except within a black hole. This is an assumption that I used. And then I had to use some technical assumptions that I don't want to discuss here. But the output of these assumptions was a model that predicts a force law for gravity, which consists of several parts. So now comes the formula. The force law contains the Newtonian piece, which is, of course, a nice consistency check. It also contains the centrifugal force that was already known in times of Kepler. It also contains the Einstein piece. So this harmless-looking term is basically the planet Vulcan, or what replaces the planet Vulcan. That's Einstein's modification of Newton's theory of gravity. Interestingly, you automatically get another term, namely a cosmological constant term. So this harmless-looking lambda times r is what contributes to 72% to the energy budget of the universe. This is the so-called dark energy. But the real surprise was that there's another term, which I called Rindler acceleration, after Austrian physicist Wolfgang Rindler. And this consists of one constant, the Rindler acceleration a, and then some radial dependence. So the upshot is that using these simplifying assumptions, I get a force law, and this force law predicts a new force at large distances, a Rindler force. Now let's apply this. So I tested this for galaxies in a very simple toy model, and again I plot the velocity profile as a function of the radial distance, and what you can see is that the solid line, which is the line that you get when you take into account the Rindler force, matches the observation considerably better than the general relativistic force law. Okay, this is one consistency check. The other consistency check was the pioneer trajectory, and there I didn't have to do very much because the statement of the pioneer anomaly is that there is an anomalous acceleration towards the sun, and this is precisely what this Rindler force predicts. Okay, so I'm almost finished. Let me conclude here with some scientific conclusions. I've presented a very simple model for gravity at large distances, which predicts a new force law, and the observational data that I've checked are compatible with this Rindler force. Perhaps a useful truism to take away from this talk is, if you get stuck with a question, then try to rephrase it or to avoid it, even though it might feel like cheating. And this may shed light on the original question. Thank you.